you stand together as we celebrate in singing hymn 145, Oh Come Let Us Adore Him.
Oh come all ye
Good morning. It's a great, great season. It's just good to be a child of God. It's just great to do more than the Christmas thing. Traditions are good. Someone says, well, you know, bad tradition is bad. Well, there's good traditions and there's not so good traditions, you know. And I like the poinsettias. I like the Christmas season. And I'm glad to be in a nation that we can acknowledge the birth of our Savior. He could have never been crucified if he wasn't born. And he was born to die. And that's an amazing thing. But on the third day, he rose again. So that gives us hope. It gives us hope. And I trust you're not all partied out. You probably are. Yeah. How many times have you said, I'll never eat again? And yet you do. Christmas is family time. So we're blessed with the Wilsons, Alan, and we're blessed with the Bynums and the Malloys from all the way from Colorado. Slid down here. I said, well, our winters aren't so bad down here, are they? But it's just good to have family with us today. You're so welcome. The Bible says if we're to have friends, we must do what? Let's do that.
You step down from heaven, humbly you came, God of all creation, here with us in a starlit manger, Emmanuel, light of the world, here to save. Adore, come let us adore. Oh, come let us adore.
Amen. You may be seated. Special time of the year, Wednesday, of course, and Christmas Eve on Tuesday, Christmas Day on Wednesday. So there's no midweek meeting this week. So we'll be back again on Sunday. And the new year was just around the corner. So we still have some fellowships this afternoon, our elementary department Christmas party right after the services. So you have little ones. We have special time for your kids. And so have a meal there for them and everything. You always have a good time. So that's our Christmas fellowship for our elementary. This evening we have special time. It's just we like to do different things. So it's going to be seasoned with light and singing and sharing. And so we encourage you to be back at our service, on our special services tonight. We still have also our outreach table there. And there's three shopping days till Christmas or something like that. But anyway, on our outreach table, we have some beautiful tracks and have all season with the Christmas message. And so if you need to stock up or get a few tracks, and visitors that are with us, we encourage you to do the same. And so who's to advance the true meaning of Christmas if it's not us? So we try to encourage each other and help each other to do that. So we want you to take advantage of that. We're about to receive our offering. This is the fourth Sunday of the month, and so we have our special Christmas fund offering. Also receive an offering for our missionaries as well. So it's good to give, you know. Christmas is about God's great gift to us, His only begotten Son. When God gave, He gave the best. And may we be faithful to give how of God, return His blessings to Him. So we'll ask our ushers to stand as we receive our offering. So Father, we contemplate the blessings of Christmas, Christ becoming flesh to dwell among us. And even today, we who have the second birth, the new birth, taking up His abode in our hearts. What a wonderful thing. And bringing to us all those great gifts like peace that passes understanding, that is never threatened. The joy that is in You, O Lord. So many things that are ours that we are just grateful for. So, Father, as we reflect upon Your goodness and grace, may it warm our hearts. May it open our hands to give back to You. Bless this offering as we receive it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare Him room, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing. Down.
God's home for the earth. And how could he love the ones who were denied him? And who'd leave a palace of gold for the sins of the world?
This is the Christmas offering, the babe who was born.
What could I give that's worthy of one so divine? And where could I go that his love isn't already there?
Who is this child that the angels sing of from the sky? This is the Christmas offering, the babe who was born. Set our hearts free. This is the Christmas offering. Heaven came down to save you and me.
A child would bring the whole world to its knees. A child became the King of all kings.
This little child is the Christmas offering.
And join us as we sing, Here Comes Heaven.
Children, weep no more. Hope is on the horizon. Weary world, behold. Your promised Messiah. Angels, let your song begin. Here comes heaven. Christ is born in Bethlehem. Here comes heaven. Sinner, let your song begin. Here comes heaven. Christ is born in Bethlehem. Here comes heaven. Here comes heaven. Now behold his glory. Glory in the highest. All the earth rejoice, for Christ is. Now behold his glory, glory in the highest. All the earth rejoice, for Christ is born. Over all who mourn breaks the dawn of salvation. Darkness reigns no more, for Jesus is greater. He is greater. Angels, let your song begin. Here comes heaven. Christ is born in Bethlehem. Here comes heaven. Angels, let your song begin. Here comes heaven. All creation worship him. Here comes heaven. Here comes heaven.
Brother Bob Jones, would you lead us in a word of prayer?
Light in a dark world, I look for truth, but settled for lies. I had been blinded, I couldn't see, till the star in Bethlehem sky opened my eyes. I have seen the light shining in the darkness, bursting through the shadows, delivering the dawn.
There in a manger, an innocent baby, who could believe that he was the one?
I can believe it, I know it's true. He changed my life.
He is the light.
He is God's son.
He is God's son.
I have seen the light shining in the darkness, bursting through the shadows, delivering the dawn.
We must.
must tell the world what we've seen today in Bethlehem. He's the promised King. We bow down and worship Him. We will worship Christ the King.
Open your Bibles. We've got two focus passages. We're going to read both of those. They're not long. Tell the story and make the application. The Christmas message from behind the door. The first passage, Genesis chapter 28, verses 10 through 17. The second, Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. Someone said the New Testament is the Old Testament concealed. The Old Testament is in the New Testament revealed. You really can't know your New Testament until you know your Old. And you can really make it, it makes it really open up. And so this is a, these are two great passages that, believe it or not, have something in common. And we're going to just blend these together. Genesis chapter 28, verse 10. Hope you're there. And Jacob went out from Beersheba and went toward Haran. And he lighted upon a certain place and tarried there all night because the sun was set. And he took of the stones of that place and put them for his pillows and lay down in that place to sleep. And he dreamed. And behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. And behold, the angels of God ascending and descending upon it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am Yahweh Elohim of Abraham, thy father, and the God of Jacob. The land whereon thou liest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed. And thy seed shall be as the dust of the earth. Thou shalt spread abroad to the east, to the west, to the east, to the north, to the south. And in thee and in thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. And behold, I am with thee. You, Jacob, and will keep thee in all places whither thou goest, and will bring thee again into this land, for I will not leave thee until I have done that which I have spoken to thee of. And Jacob awaked out of his sleep, and he said, surely the Lord is in this place. And I knew it not. And he was afraid and said, how dreadful, how awesome is this place? This is none other but the house of God. And this is the gate of heaven. Matthew chapter 1, verse 18. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make a public example of her, was minded to put her away privily or divorce her without drawing attention. And while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary, thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now all of this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord, by the prophet, saying, behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not until she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. The following is from the book, The Birth, by Gene Edwards. The carpenter smashed his mallet upon the table, picked it up again, and threw it against the wall. Then he turned and kicked at the door until his foot was numb. Circling the room in a dance of madness, the young man came at last to the center of the room, placed his hands over his ears, threw back his head, and screamed at the top of his voice. When he could do that no longer, Joseph dropped to the floor, buried his face in the sawdust, and wept uncontrollably. He raised his head and between his dry lips cried, Mary, Mary, how could you do this? Once more, Joseph clenched his fist and in some ceremonial cadence began beating the floor. Everything about her said she loved her Lord, the young man anguished. She was the purest thing I have ever known. If Mary cannot be trusted, then no man can trust any woman who ever lived. He stood and cried out again, how could she do this? It's inconceivable. How? How? The sobs exploded from Joseph's soul. I will never marry her. I will never marry anyone. I will never trust a woman, never. Emotionally spent on the edge of exhaustion, the young carpenter fell once more to the floor and cried himself to sleep. At that moment, the door swung open. Gabriel slipped through the portal, surveyed the destruction Joseph had inflicted upon his wood shop, and then tenderly knelt beside the young man who was lost in sleep. Son of David, Joseph, don't be afraid. Take Mary as your wife. The child in her was conceived with the Holy Spirit. When he is born, call his name Jesus. This is that one who will save his people from their sins. Joseph moved slightly, let out a long sigh, and began to breathe evenly. The agonizing groans that had been rising from his throat ceased. Gently, Gabriel laid his hand upon Joseph's forehead and waited. Waited until his sleep flowed evenly and peace had worked its way across his face. And then Gabriel spoke again. Our God has well chosen the man who will raise the very Son of the Most High God. And Joseph, as you will learn in the days and years to come, God has chosen his mother and your wife. With that, Gabriel slipped back through the door and into his own realm. Joseph opened his eyes. What he saw was a room, and no, an entire world quite changed from what had been just a few hours earlier. In Matthew chapter 1, verse 20, Gabriel passed through the gate. The portal, the door of heaven to visit Joseph. Joseph, who was struggling with the news from Mary that she was with child by the Holy Spirit, fell asleep and dreamed. And it's not uncommon at all for us to dream about those things that preoccupy our minds and hearts during the daytime. In Joseph's dream, he beheld the angel of the Lord, Gabriel, who was dispatched by God and stepped through the door. And he made his way down the ladder. He was on a mission to confirm Mary's story and give Joseph instruction about his role in the Christmas drama. Praise God, Joseph listened to God's angelic messenger, Gabriel, and he made room for Mary as well as the Christ child, Jesus. And perhaps like Jacob, and perhaps like Joseph, this Christmas finds you in the midst of some struggle, some conflict. It could be most anything. It could be family strife. It could be financial woes. It could be health problems. It could be the loss of a loved one. Your first Christmas without him or without her, or some other difficulty that agonizes your soul this Christmas. The trouble that has visited you could well be the result of your own disobedience, like Jacob, who had that nature, you know? Or it could be something that has come upon you providentially, like Joseph. Whatever the situation, this Christmas, God wants you to hear his message from behind the door. A preacher once said, the hinge of history is on the door of a Bethlehem stable. And God has given us the wonderful gift of his word, and in it a message that will hopefully give you some help and hope this Christmas season. So, what is the message from behind the door? Here are three Christmas proclamations from behind the door given in our text passages. First, Christmas proclamation one. God is with us. Matthew 1:23, Gabriel told Joseph that this was the one known as Emmanuel, which means God with us. There was a time preceding this Christmas announcement when it seemed like the door was shut. It seemed like the heavenly ladder had been retracted. And it was a time frame when people thought, perhaps, that God had forgotten mankind, that he was not with us. That period is known as the silent years. Some call it the dark years. Others know it as the intertestament period. It was a period of 400 years in which nothing was heard from God. Not a word, not revelation, nothing, just silence. Psalm 74, verse 9 says, "We see not our signs. There is no more any prophet, neither is there among us any that knoweth how long." 400 years is a long time. From our earthbound perspective, it appeared during this frame time at least that God was inactive. With the last chapter, the last verse of Malachi, the end of the old covenant had folded, and the curtain had dropped. Act 1, the old covenant was over. But yet God was preparing the stage for Act 2. The new covenant. We gain an expression of this reality in the New Testament. Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. The Bible's a marvelous book. And here the Apostle Paul says, it says that when the fullness of what? I quote that a lot, the fullness of time. But notice, the time. Do you understand that? God had a special time for this event. That when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth His Son, made of a woman, made under the law. That phrase, the time, it lets us see things from God's perspective. You see, God is never late. God is always on time. He's never without purpose, and He is never, ever without a plan. And because of this, God is never inactive. He is never idle. Just because we cannot see God's activities, anticipate His timing, or understand His ways, doesn't mean He is not working behind the scenes, behind the curtain, so to speak. We can always be sure that God accomplishes things in His own time and His own way, not ours. I don't know about you, but I'm always in a hurry and God isn't. I've already figured out how God is going to take care of this. The angel Gabriel had earlier slipped through the door before he did with Joseph to Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist, the forerunner of Jesus, breaking God's silence. And it was just the first of many messages to come, informing us that our greatest fears were unfounded. God had not forgiven us. God had never left us. God was with us all along. The coming of Jesus Christ meant that God was with us in a new and exciting way. He was with us in a new dimension. Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. And John chapter 1, verse 14 reads, "And the Word, the eternal Word, was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." J.I. Packer once said, "The incarnation is in itself an unfathomable mystery, but it makes sense of everything else that the New Testament contains." You see, becoming flesh, dwelling with us, Jesus is able to live a life, live the life that we could not live. Victorious over sin. As Emmanuel, He is able to taste death for everyone. as Emmanuel, he's able to live, to rise again victoriously over the grave. As Emmanuel, Jesus is equipped to be our faithful high priest who can sympathize with us, having experienced this earthly existence firsthand, because he's Emmanuel. When we suffer pain, there is in us this desire for others to understand. That never takes place. I mean, we want others to see, to feel, and experience life as we do, so that they can understand our world, so that they can somehow identify with us. When Jesus became a man, he forever became one of us. And he's forever with us. Did you hear the message? He's Emmanuel. God with us. Let me tell you something. God is with us even when we're not with him. I mean, that name Jacob, it means schemer, cheater, someone who grabs from behind. Jacob's life was a testimony to living as if there was no God at all. How many times do we as Christians live like practical atheists? None of us are particularly surprised to find someone who consistently evidences a flaw in his or her character. But what surprises us is to learn that even though Jacob continues, and he does, oh, does he, continue to struggle with a flawed character, God continually makes himself known to him. Jacob, I'm still here. Jacob, I still have plans for you. I still have plans for you. God continually makes himself known. I'm with you, even though Jacob wasn't always with God. In Genesis 28, God reminds Jacob that he's known as the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac, right? And by the way, and Jacob. The prophet Isaiah shouts the reality, the lament that every soul here today has heard. And in Isaiah chapter 53 verse 6, we all like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord hath laid upon him the iniquity of us all. Jesus, the good shepherd, is the one who leaves the 99 and goes after that one lost sheep. Are you glad that God is with us? And he's with us even sometimes when we're not with him. Don't forget, child of God, he's with you. It's a good thing that God is with us, because as Paul says, in him we live and we move and we have our being. The one thing you cannot afford to lose is God. You can live without and live without, and we live in this American culture. You got to have, you got to have. You're not complete. You can't be happy if you don't have. Oh, if you only had that, I'll tell you what, take all of that away and give me Jesus. Is with us. Here's the second proclamation, Christmas proclamation number two. God can be in us. In Matthew 1:20, the angel of the Lord told Joseph that the child in Mary's womb, look at this, was conceived by the Holy Spirit. In a literal sense, God was in Mary. I mean, the mothers in our midst know firsthand what it means to have a child cohabiting in them. Once conception takes place, that new life is hardly noticeable. We look hard at that first sonogram to see it. However, months later, that little baby grows and grows until its presence is conspicuous and, can I say, controlling. Think about sharing space with another human being, sharing space with God as a human being. And for sure, Mary could say that God was indeed in her. Contrary to popular belief, God is not in all of us. Are you with me? I mean, while God is not in all of us, the good news of Christmas is that He can be. I mean, when you're saved, God the Holy Spirit, He comes to make His abode within you. He comes to abide in you. Take up His rest. Just as Jesus came to tabernacle among us, when we accept Christ, He comes to tabernacle within us. Can I have an amen on that? John chapter 14, verse 16, Jesus promised us as believers that He would send one known as the Paraclete, the Comforter, the Divine Helper, who would walk along beside us, but also abide in us. Forever. And then Jesus said in John 14, 16, I will not leave you orphanos. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. The Lord God desires to dwell in our hearts by faith. And just as He was born into this world, Jesus wants to be born into your heart and your life. And we're going through the Gospel of John, but just recently in John chapter 3, verses 6 and 7, Jesus looked at Nicodemus and He says, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I say unto you, you must be what? Born again, born from above. And once Jesus is in your heart through the spiritual birth, like an embryo, His presence and influence is to grow and grow, consuming, controlling more and more and more of your thoughts and your desires and your dreams. If you're saved, it's not if you have Christ, if you have the Holy Spirit. The question is, does He have all of you? Are you yielding yourself to Him? In Galatians chapter 4, verse 19, the Apostle Paul says, my little children, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in you. You ain't got to understand. The new birth is just the beginning. It's from there we grow in faith and grow in grace. And once Jesus is in your heart through that new spiritual birth, He begins to grow. One Sunday on their way home from church, a little girl turned to her mom and asked the question, is God bigger than we are, like the preacher said? Well, of course, she says, God's bigger than us. Then she said, well, it's true that God lives in us. Well, yes, God lives in us. When we trust in Christ by faith, He comes to live in us. The girl thought a while and says, well, if God is bigger than us and lives in us, shouldn't He show through? Well, light's on. Isn't that the point? Live it out. Jesus Christ is in us. Not to cower in the corner of our lives, but to show through. Can I say shine through? Paul reminds us in Philippians 2:13, for it is God that worketh in you both to will and to what? And do of who? His good pleasure. And because God is in us, Paul says we can do all things through Christ. He says in Philippians, he that begun is going to continue that which He has promised. Because God is in us, we can. God is with us, and He can be in us. If God is in you, He will be seen. What are people seeing in your life? Are they seeing hope, or are they seeing despair and defeat? Proclamation 1, God is with us. Proclamation 2, He can be in us. The question, is He? Here's the third proclamation, Christmas proclamation. God is for us. I mean, when mankind sinned, God could have remained behind the door. When man sinned, God could have remained aloof and indifferent to our pain and to our need. God could have been just and just left us to suffer the consequences of our evil doing. God could have burst through the door on the other hand with His mighty angels and just consumed us. I mean, you could go all the way back to the Garden of Eden with the first sin. I mean, God could have said, instead of saying, Adam, where art thou? He knew exactly where he was. God could have just destroyed everything and started over and been just in doing it. God gently opened the door, sending His only begotten Son into the world in the form of a baby. What a great God we know and serve. Gabriel told Joseph in Matthew 21, call His name Jesus. He shall save His people from their sins. We're told in John 3:17, for God sent not His Son into the world to what? Condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. Because God is for us, He sent us His Son. Because God is for us, He sent us a Savior. Because God is for us, He said, call His name Jesus, which means Jehovah is salvation. Later, Jesus would clearly state His purpose on the earth by saying that He came to seek and to save that which was lost. And if you are in your sin, you can be sure that God is seeking you. He's waiting with outstretched arms. He is with us. He longs to be in us because He's for us. And He's waiting for us with those arms open wide. No. Not to condemn you. Not at all. But to save you, to redeem you. I mean, this is God, isn't He? From Genesis all the way through to the last book, the last chapter, come, He says. And the Spirit and the bride say, come. In Genesis chapter 1, it's God who stands at the garden and says, Adam, where are you? He is for us. He's not against us. British Christian author and apologist C.S. Lewis was saved in a car. I don't know where you were saved. That moment, wasn't that a wonderful moment when you trusted Christ? Man, the Holy Spirit was upon you, you know? And He was magnifying your sin. And, you know, God can use so many ways. C.S. Lewis had a friend. He began his life as an atheist. He disliked church. Most people who aren't saved don't like church. But the more he considered the Scriptures, the more he listened to a friend who witnessed to him, the more he realized, especially the Gospels, were truthful. Historically, every way. Lewis said about the Gospels as he was journeying toward Christ. He says, nothing else in all of literature is just like this. So, on a car trip to the zoo, of all places, Lewis took that final step of faith. This is what he says. When we set out, I did not believe that Jesus Christ was the Son of God. But when we reached the zoo, I did. The light of Jesus broke through on the way to the zoo. I got to thinking, what if it was during while we was at the zoo? Where were you saved? Between the baboons and the chimpanzees. Or I was saved looking at the reptile exhibit. In Lewis's own words, he described his salvation experience in the back seat of a car on the way to the zoo in three words: surprised by joy. Now, if you're going to put your conversion experience into words and feelings, that moment when the light of Christ penetrated your heart, that'd be good. That'd be one good way to put it. Surprised by joy. How many people remember the load of guilt and sin that dropped from your shoulders? How many remember the feeling of being redeemed, knowing that you're God's own child? I mean, if you'll give the Lord a chance, He will save you because He's with us. He longs to be in us, and He's for us. And this is why He sent His Son, not to condemn us, but to save us. One plus God is a majority, they say. Because God is for you, you can face anything. Because God is for you, you can face anything. I say this often here. Knowing Jesus Christ affects everything. Even how you face trials. How you face problems and stress. I mean, because God's for you, you can face cancer. You can face the loss of a loved one. You can face broken relationships. You can face financial reversals. You can face a devastating legal decision. You can face the betrayal of those that you trusted. You can face ridicule. You can face rejection and meanness of the crowds. You can face whatever life throws at you because God is for you. The great Christmas message from behind the door is God is with you, God can be in you, and God is for you. The coming of Jesus into the world means that God is not our enemy. No. God really longs to be your friend. And it means that God is not detached. God is not distant. No. God is involved in our lives today. He is moving in this world. It means that God cares about us. That means He was willing to stand with us even through the darkest times. Though I go through the valley of the shadow of death, we walked that valley this last month. Thou art what? With me. You need to remember that God is with you and in you and for you. No matter where you are in life, no matter what you're facing now, the question is, do you need to come out from behind the door? Do you need to step into the light of Jesus' presence through faith? And even salvation. Christmas reminds us that God cares. Do you need to come out into the presence of God and ask forgiveness for your sins or to restore your fellowship with Him? You know, Jacob says, God was with me and He was here all along and I didn't even realize it. Maybe God just is using whatever is in your life to pull you back to Him, to wake you up and to shake you and say, I'm here. Is Jesus the focus of your heart, the focus of your life this Christmas? You need to come to Jesus and accept God's gift for you. That is the message of Christmas. Let's bow our heads. Father, you know everyone here. This is the Christmas season. We have family. We have extended family. We have friends with us today. You know everyone. You know who they are. You know who you indwell and who you don't. Who's come to you in repentance and faith and said, yes, yes, yes. I know who I am and I know why you came. And I need your Savior. Oh, you know the lost here today. Maybe having a testimony of religion, but not having the possession of the Holy Spirit, knowing for sure that Christ is in your heart. Father, could be believers here, no doubt, that this is not the best Christmas ever. No, this is a difficult one. Things in the life stacking up like traffic, overwhelming. And I pray that through this message and through the experience of Jacob and Joseph, they could be reminded that God is for them. That you, oh God, care about them. That you're standing, wet ready, waiting to help them through whatever it is. Father, I pray that you would just speak to our hearts. Humble us. May we admit our need of a Savior, of a sin bearer, of a burden bearer. May your presence be real in our lives this morning. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We stand with our heads bowed. Just stand up quietly, leaving you nothing to do.